This is John Cullough with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. We're here in Los Angeles, and actually this guy was featured in the LA Times, like in the newspaper, on how he literally just has a small lot. He has one lot. His house is on like a 7,000 square foot lot. His house is maybe 2,000 square feet of that. So he's growing in 5,000 square feet in the backyard. But also many, like in 2012, like 10 years ago, he bought the lot next door and he started growing in that also. And so he has over 200 to 300 fruit trees, like literally in about 12,000 square feet of space in his backyard. And he spaces the trees like as close as 3 feet. You know, some trees will space more. He's trying to be as sustainable as possible, so he catches his rainwater off the roof. He also uses gray water from his kitchen sink, so he could water some of his trees. He tends to underwater his trees. So like his motto is like, you know, the tree's gotta be strong and make it on its own. Although he will water when they're young to get them established. So once the tree's got nice long roots, he lets them kind of do what they want. And I don't want to hear any excuses from you guys, because this guy is a school teacher. He works like school teachers work a lot. You know, we got to appreciate the school teacher. So, hey, bring your school teacher some kind of cool gift, you know, if you got kids in school. But anyways, he's a third grade teacher. He's working a lot. He would come home after work and then he'd work in his garden. And in addition between being a school teacher, he's also an artist. So then he'd work in the daytime before it got night in the garden. And then at night, then he'd go do his artwork. So man, this guy is busy, but yet he has an amazing fruit tree orchard in his backyard here in Los Angeles. And we're on like a pretty good slope. And it basically, he modified the slope to kind of terrace it all like over time, took many years. So I'm glad he invited me here today to share with you guys how he's growing all these fruit trees, like literally in his backyard in LA. So let's head to the back. So this is a very cool and special backyard. I really love all the different levels. It makes it, you know, a lot more exciting than just like a flat lot. Like he has all these stairs going down. He has like tree houses and he has pathways. He's got retaining walls and he's got, of course, all the lovely fruit trees. You know, this happens, he's made tags for a lot of them. This is a Dorset Golden, like a plum. And like, he's got a lot of avocados and mangoes. He'll put nets over his trees, like a persimmon, so that the birds don't get the fruit. You guys can see he's using some best practices down here. He's mulching with leaves as well as wood chips to retain the water so he could actually water the trees less, because this literally puts a layer on the ground so that the water evaporation doesn't happen. In addition, he's also fertilizing his trees by using the leaves and the wood chips that break down into the nutrients that will feed the trees. What better thing to feed trees than other trees? You know, by chipping up the wood chips and also the leaves that drop. I mean, everything that's needed to grow a tree is in the leaves, because that's what was in the tree. So now this will just break back down and feed the tree. So it's like a cycle. Of course, around his garden, he has all these little artwork pieces. He used to be into ceramics and now he does like paintings and stuff. And so yeah, here's a fig tree and he's got all these nice little cool paths. Oh, and check this out. This big tube comes from his roof, so when it rains he could move this tube to different places in his yard to basically let the water soak into the ground instead of run off into the gutter, into the sidewalk, and you know, go somewhere else. Now the city has to deal with it and there could be flooding, but this way he puts the water back into the ground where it belongs, you know, to give his trees the hydration they need. Now the cool thing is, because he has so many fruit trees, there is always a tree here in Los Angeles that's fruiting and he can eat, right? This week it might be jujubes. Next week it might be mangoes. Next week it might be apples. Next week it might be avocados. So many different things. He has figs, and check this out. He's got some guavas right here. And these are like the strawberry guavas. These are some of my favorite ones. I really like when they get dark. A little bit dried out because they had some like 100 degree weather. Nice and concentrated. Really high in vitamin C. I mean, look at all these fruits. Like if this was my place, I'd probably water a tad bit more. Once again, he wants to try to conserve water, but more importantly, he wants to see what is possible in LA. If you guys watch and own a place in LA, you could grow some of these fruit trees, and we'll interview him at the end so you guys could learn not to waste your time and grow the best fruit trees that'll perform the best for you, because he's done a lot of experimentation for you, spending thousands of dollars on fruit trees A lot of them made it, but some didn't. And I'm gonna have him share this information with you guys so that you guys can just plant the ones that work really good and have lots of fruit teeth. So let's go ahead and continue the tour. So of course, one of the easiest trees to grow here in Southern California is citrus, and he has lots of different kinds of citrus. And he's got, I really like how he uses the trees to basically prop up or use the tree as a trellis to grow things like dragon fruit. You can see the dragon fruit flowers right there. They're really pretty. And I wanna let you guys know that some fruits are more laborious than others. So like dragon fruits, you probably should hand pollinate, whereas a lot of fruit trees may be self-pollinating so that you don't have to do anything. And that's how he's able to get a lot of fruit, because he has so many trees, and even without coming out here every single day, you know, he's successful. And that's why he doesn't necessarily grow vegetables. Vegetables are a lot more work. You gotta tend to them often. They could dry out faster, but a fruit tree is more resilient once established. That's the most important thing. If you guys learned anything today, and it's and you can make a fruit tree more resilient or less depending on how you plant it. You know, planting it in good soil, he gives compost tea on a regular basis, adding things like rock dust, which I would agree with, as well as worm castings. And of course, he uses all that mulch. And he's got all kinds of little stairways to go up to like the next level. I think this is going up to the next property, the next lot next door that he bought, the 7,000 more square feet. And you guys can see like the terraces that he put in here. And he brought these stones in like, you know, a bunch at a time. And then sometimes he just go and picks them up after work and then just, you know, put them in place one stone at a time. So like, this did not appear overnight. It took him many years to get it to where it is today. You know, he bought fruit trees from many different nurseries, many locals, some he mail orders. I mean, this is a nice papaya. He's got a couple bright papayas on there. And these guys, to me, like look like they're underwatered, you know? And, you know, he does that purposely, because once again, he doesn't want to use a lot of water. And because he has so many fruit trees, he's always going to get some fruit, even if he tends to underwater, and some of them don't look like super healthy. But this is where you can see, like, look at this. Like, these fruit trees are extremely close together. Like maybe 5 feet apart. And so he's got a lot of dwarf rootstocks, so some of these trees won't get too tall. Otherwise he can prune them. Of course, some trees like mangoes, he'll give a lot more space to let them grow, you know, a lot bigger. Some trees I really want to encourage you guys to grow besides just the fruit trees is I want you guys to grow vegetable trees. Vegetable trees are so important. We need to eat our greens. Some fruit trees actually have edible leaves, but this tree is a tree that actually is grown for the leaves. It's actually just called chaya. This, you should cook this before consuming, but I mean, you could just come out to your chaya tree, which is just full of leaves, harvest a bunch and just cook it up, like, and then just eat it like you would spinach, right? It could be quite excellent. And he has other trees that you can do that with also. Like, this is one of my favorites. This is known as the katuk. And this actually kind of tastes like, my friend says it tastes like peanut butter, like these little leaves right here. But the leaves have a nice nutty flavor raw. They're completely amazing. One of my favorite trees to grow, or shrubs, you know, to eat. So Jose is trying to be as sustainable as possible. So he's got a compost tumbler that he's had for many years. This is the one actually I recommend. It's the Lifetime 80 gallon tumbling composter. So this is great if you don't have like a big yard, you have a small amount of space, you can put your compost in here and tumble it. You know, but actually these days he stopped using it because he found something, a better way to compost. So let me go ahead and show you guys that over here. And his better way of composting is simply right here underneath this board. What he does is he literally digs a hole in the ground, right, and puts all his fruit, food scraps in there and clippings, and then he'll just take this dirt and then bury this. So he's like literally burying his food. Now when you bury your food, it'll rot underneath the ground, but more importantly, this will be food for things like earthworms, right? So he's burying it here. The earthworms will come, they'll eat all the food, they'll basically poop out their worm casting, which is actually nutritious, water-soluble fertilizer for the plants. And then once he does that, then he'll plant a tree here. So now he's basically made fertility in the spot he needs it to grow the trees that he's growing. Isn't that amazing? Now this way he doesn't have to sift compost, he doesn't have to bring the compost over, it's just where it needs to be. And worm casting compost is far better than the bacterial-based compost made in a tumbler for fruit trees. So it's very important in urban areas to protect your fruit. What is it? PTF. Protect your fruit, otherwise nature will get it, right? He's happy to share his fruit with the birds. In some cases, some fruit trees, the birds will get all the fruit, but if there's something he really likes, he'll actually put a net over it. So like this just clear netting here, This net was actually on this tree, a pluot tree, where he got lots of pluots, and when he has excess, his family will eat some. He'll bring it into his school, share it with the family. He'll give it to friends and even like a community food, fridge, so that local people can enjoy his fruit when he has abundance. I would encourage you guys to share your abundance that you're growing. But yeah, the one way you can get abundance is to protect the fruit so that the birds don't get it. So this is protecting a Fuji, like a persimmon tree, so that he'll be getting some persimmons in the near future. So this is the tree that I think everybody in Los Angeles or Southern California should own. I mean, it's just my favorite tree. This has grown like really well for him. He says this is a fast growing tree and it puts out lots of fruit. You will not be able to eat all the fruit that this tree produces. I mean, look at this tree. We can pull this down. Fruit, 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 fruit. Maybe it's called the Jamaican cherry or Jamaican strawberry. And you can see it has these like little red fruits on here. And these little red fruits, they taste amazing. I don't know, they just taste so fruity to me. They're so sweet. And they have a little bite at the end. It tastes like strawberry banana cream. And so there's a lot of red fruits on the tree that you could harvest, right? And these are like great for kids because they're like little berries and they have such an amazing flavor. Like you'd have to buy candy to eat something this good. But the cool thing is, if you look on the ground, the tree's dropping all the fruit, right? You can just come to the ground and pick the fruits off the ground. So good. Grow one of these trees. They're amazing, trust me. I don't want to show you guys one of the failures, right? Now, don't be alarmed. If you guys have a failure, you buy a fruit tree and it doesn't do well, right? Jose here, he's planted fruit trees and sometimes they die, and that's all right. That's a learning lesson. Like, hey, when I planted this fruit tree in this location, it didn't make it. And that's gonna be all right. You're gonna have some learning lessons, and that's how we learn, right? And you'll learn which trees are gonna do good and which ones aren't by trying and experimenting. And that's simply what he's done. He's just gotten a lot of fruit trees, tried them over the many years, and now he ends up with like 200 to 300. What's not doing so good for him is his vegetable garden. So this is his vegetable garden area. And because of the water crisis, everything going on and the excessive heat here, like look at his vegetable garden. Like this is a pepper plant. It's barely alive. Some of the herbs are kind of doing it. I mean, this guy just straight up dried out. And if you fail, that's all right, right? And once again, he's so busy, he doesn't have time to tend to this every single day. And if you don't have time to tend to a vegetable garden, that's all right. Put in fruit trees because they're way less work once established. That's the key. Once established and use the right practices to grow them successfully, like he's doing here, like the mulch, like the compost tea, like putting a worm bin right where you're gonna plant your trees so there's instant fertility for you. And you could surely do it too. I wanna show you guys another way he's being more sustainable here in LA. All right, another way that they're being sustainable here is basically this black pipe goes from the kitchen, from the sink, to right here. So if you are gonna do this, it's very important to use like, you know, natural detergents that are not gonna harm the trees. I use this one called Oasis. That's what I use personally. But basically he has a pipe coming out and he put these connectors together, right? So he could just have a connector and then he could connect the hose and then he could run the hose, which is open on the other end, to the different trees that he wants to water at the time. And he put it here so he doesn't glue it. So in case this gets leaked or clogged up, he could just pull this out and run a snake up there or just flush water through here. And if there's any kind of overflow, it just overflows in this bucket. And then you can take the bucket loads and put that under the trees that he wants. So yeah, in this way, he's conserving water because he uses such a small amount of virgin water from the city to water his trees. He lets the rain do it. He lets the rain capture into the ground. He uses the, you know, water he catches off the roof as well as the water from the sinks. And that's how he's literally able to grow all these trees. Of course, when trees are young, he does use some city water to get them established, and once they're established, then their roots will go deep and then absorb the water already existing in the ground. Now there's a lot more that I'd love to show you guys today, but I'm on time crunch and I want to interview Jose. But before I do, I want to show you guys some of his amazing artwork that is inspired by the garden. All right, so now we're in the art studio, and you can see he probably creates a lot of art right here at this table. And standing desk, very important, that's adjustable. But the cool thing, check out this wall. This is like a retaining wall underneath the house here. And he's basically listed all the different varieties of trees that he originally planted. Now, some of these are not living, but basically when he bought all the trees, he basically made a map and it like weaves around his yard. So the way it weaves around his yard, he basically has them all listed. So look at all these trees, these fruit trees he's growing in his backyard that he has all labeled here so he knows what's outside. Of course, a lot of the trees also have little tags on them, but this is so amazing, like all the different varieties he grows, and he grows, I mean, you think you go to the store and you get mangoes, and he has like Nam Dak Mai mangoes and Opportuna and Chirimoya and so many different cool varieties, because there's like, people know that there's like Granny Smith apples, Golden Delicious apples, but there's like so many different kinds of mangoes, and when you go to the store, it's only labeled mango. It could be a Keat, could be a Kent, and unfortunately it's not some of these more rare varieties, you know, that he's growing here, like Desert Delight Nectarines, Flavor Delight Aprium, Santa Rosa Plums, Katy Apricots. I mean, you could just see, and this is just so cool the way he's done this in art, but also it's a functional retaining wall for the house. Now I want to show you guys even a special space, and I love this, he has like a little stairs right here. We go down and this is like his art gallery, you know, and some of these pieces are for sale, so if you want to contact him, his Instagram link is down below, you can contact him if you want to buy any of these pieces. These pieces are all based around, you know, the art that he makes, and he went to school for art at Berkeley actually. So this is like, you know, the a mango tree, and it's showing like, you know, putting mulch underneath the mango tree to like add fertility so it'll be nice and healthy. You know, this one down here is like a plant-based, so you can see all the different fruits and vegetables that are healthy to eat. And he has like all different kinds of art. I mean, these are just really cool. Like you can see, like this is like, it's got all these fruit trees kind of built in. And he talked to me about like what some of these guys are. Like that's a big canvas right there. But this is one of my favorites, right? This one right here, because this shows like the city behind, and this is like urban garden where people are actually painting the nature, and also, but they're like growing fruit trees, and there's like community, they're having meetings, they're working together. It's just like an amazing piece of art. And you'd have to ask him what like all these ones are, but they're like, I don't know, they're just really cool. I just really love the design and how he does it. I mean, here's a big one behind me here. And look, this is like a dresser wardrobe case that he's like totally got painted up too. So yeah, this dude's amazing. You know, not only does he be a school teacher helping out and teaching the kids, not only is he a backyard farmer growing his own food on his property to share with the community, not only is he an artist, but yeah, and now we're gonna interview him to share with you guys more about how he thinks and why he did all this and why he is growing food like literally in his backyard in LA. All right, so now I have the pleasure of interviewing Jose, and this is his amazing place here that I got to give you guys a tour of. And I'm gonna ask him some questions. So Jose, why did you decide to plant like 200 to 300 fruit trees in your backyard, like as close as 3 feet apart?
It's an experiment, and it was fun, and it was something that I wanted to learn about. Trees and fruit and food has always been important. Having access to fresh fruit is healthier. And I had kind of like wanted to see what could grow in Los Angeles and what doesn't grow in LA, and I've been finding out that a lot of things will grow in LA as long as like you're patient and you give them the right, you have healthy soil basically. If you have some good healthy soil, you can grow a lot of different things in LA.
So I know not everything you've always grown has succeeded. I mean, your place looks amazing, and yeah, you got a couple things that aren't alive maybe because of the recent heat wave we had and for other reasons of course. But if somebody wants to like not grow through your growing pains, literally buying thousands of dollars that hopefully your wife didn't complain too much about spending all this money on fruit trees and then they died, what should somebody plant that you could almost say like with this one, you're gonna get fruit every single year so you're gonna be successful? Because for me, it's important to make it easy for people. But hey, some people love to experiment, but for people that just want to know, what do I grow that's gonna make fruit every year so I could eat out of it?
Okay, well, equally as important as the stuff that's alive in your garden is to have dead things in your garden, right? And that dead stuff feeds the living things. But I would say that citrus grows really well in Southern California. Pomegranates, jujubes, figs, have some good success with apples. After a few tries, the avocados are doing really well. It took us like, you know, a lot of tries and a lot of them died, but after a while, like we have them and they're big and they're producing fruit. So it was definitely well worth the effort. Just gotta be patient with them. Papayas have been doing really well. Just don't overwater them. The first few times that I grew papayas, I would come out during the middle of the day, a heat wave, and I would see them wilting, so I would add more water. And what I was doing was I was drowning them because they naturally wilt to kind of conserve their energy during a heat wave. So I didn't know that at the beginning, but having known that, now we have some really nice papaya trees, and it's definitely worth having fresh papayas because they have a lot of health benefits and stuff. So figs don't need a lot of help. They do really well. The pomegranates and the jujubes are all really drought tolerant trees that produce really well as well.
How about the sapote? I know your neighbor had a big white sapote tree, and those are one of my favorite fruits. How do those do?
They do well. We had one as well. It was so big, and I wasn't taking advantage of all the fruit. It would always drop, and I would be putting them back in the compost, but they do really well. We have some sapodillas that are doing really well after many years, and they're beginning to produce some fruit. And we have the mamey as well that's doing pretty good. It hasn't fruited yet, but it's not that big yet either.
Yeah, that the mamey look really healthy. So yeah. What are your biggest failures that you would recommend that people don't try because they didn't work for you and they have a smaller probability of succeeding potentially?
Well, sadly, I mean, I'm a big fan of apricots and stone fruit, and right now I seem to be having an issue with stone fruit trees getting this worm in the trunk that kind of kills them slowly. So little by little, a lot of them have been dying. I'm still going to do some research to see which varieties or which rootstocks might survive in this climate or might be able to not get sick from that disease that's killing a lot of them. Other than that, I tried growing chocolate, and I had a chocolate tree, and it was going really well, and I don't know what got into me, but I decided to move it, and that's when it died. I don't know why I did that, but it was growing, and it was producing a lot of new growth. Now, I mean, everything can grow. You just got to give it a lot of love and water, of course.
So here's a good question for you. How does the nature that you're in your backyard, inspire your art, but more importantly, your art also inspire your nature, right? So how do they connect?
Well, similar to being a teacher, I think like being an artist can help you break out of like the mold or like be creative or think out of the box. And so I'm always like using that to my advantage in the garden and thinking of ways like what you might not think would work and say, hey, why not try it? Or like also in terms of like the aesthetic of the garden or being able to walk around and see different art pieces as well. And then in the art, I mean, there's so much of it is going into my art, and I think it's really important that I document the stuff that's happening with my garden in terms of making paintings of it, because that's what artists do, is like we document stuff and we bring things to light, we bring things that are important to people's attention.
Wonderful. And I showed your pieces, you know, in your art studio there. And if those are for sale, how can somebody get a hold of you or see what you're selling at present time? If somebody wants to, you know, help you out with more money so you can buy more fruit trees, your wife don't get mad.
Great question. I have a website, ramirezart.com, and I have my artwork there. I also have like 20 years worth of artwork there. I have a section on my garden, and so my paintings are available there and other merchandise that I've created, and also you can see my work on Instagram. My handle is Jose Ramirez Art on Instagram.
Wonderful. I'll put links down below the video. So I got to run because, Jose, I wish I had more time, but I got to run to my next appointment.
Right on.
But like, if you had one thing to tell all my viewers today, like some important information about growing food or just life in general that like you think everybody should know, what is it?
Figure out a way to water your trees without relying on water from the city, man. Because we gotta be able to still have food even when we don't have as much water. And also approach everything with love and like curiosity, and know that it's gonna help you become a better person as well.
Wise words, yeah, especially in these times of drought and less water. I mean, Jose's like learning which trees, like the pomegranate and the figs, right, require less water. What are some other trees, real quick, that require less water, you know, that could still be plentiful? You know, so jujube, I know, is another one that grows in the desert that'll do pretty good on with lower water requirements, but still produce really good fruit.
Definitely, I would say citrus has been a surprising one, because we have a lot of citrus trees around the garden, and I don't water them a lot, but you know, after the first 2 or 3 years that it takes for them to get established, they might look scraggly the first few years, but after 3 years, they start to grow, and we've had a steady supply of citrus throughout the whole year. So we have different varieties. The youngest ones I started planting are the kumquats, and I started getting a lot of different varieties of kumquats. Those are still small, but they're not dead, and they survived this heat wave, and so I know they're going to do well.
Wow. Yeah, so you guys could grow food and save water. And I want to remind you guys, if you guys have space to grow a garden or grow your own food, do it. Because here's why. Because you will always be more efficient than industrial agriculture that cannot control the precise amount of water. They're just blanketing water. And to let you guys know also, 80% of the water goes to, you know, agriculture, not for people. And meanwhile, you know, governments are telling us to conserve water. Why doesn't agriculture conserve water? We can conserve water better than agriculture. And so growing your own food will save more water so that everybody can be more plentiful and happy on the planet. That's all I'm going to say. So anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode visiting Jose, his amazing garden, seeing his amazing art, give this video a big thumbs up. I'll come back on my next trip or one of these upcoming trips, and I could really go into detail more about what he's doing because I really just skimmed the surface. He has so many cool things. I just love how he set this up and all the pathways and different levels, and you got to go up and down and tree houses and things. You could like look over the whole garden. It's just an amazing place, and I wish you guys could be here to see it. But yeah, thumbs this up. Also, be sure to share this with somebody else. If you guys have friends that live in LA, share this video with them so that they could learn how you could grow a lot of fruit trees in your backyard and conserve water at the same time. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that will come out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I show up or what all you'll be learning on my channel. And make sure you click the bell so you get notified as many videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. I'll put some episodes down below that I filmed in LA also, showing other people growing amazing things on terraced hillsides and all kinds of cool things that I've visited in the past here in LA. There's lots of people doing cool stuff, and I want you guys growing too. That's why I make all these videos. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.